well as all of you to come and attend these lectures. I have tried to make it as simple as possible though, so that common people like you and me can understand it and make some benefit avail out of it. This time I would like to cover the shoulder region. We see very commonly many types of shoulder pain in day-to-day practice. Many people do have shoulder pains and neglect going to doctors, thinking that it may be some common thing. Most of the people think that it is heart pain and they go to cardiologists, get up tested wrongly. Even I have known people who have come out getting a bypass done for wrong or right reasons. But there are many conditions which are localized to the shoulder pain, which are referred from the shoulder and from the shoulder, and we can discuss all of this today. You see, our human hands, as we know, evolution has come up from animals. So the front legs have turned into hands in humans, and because of that it has gained lot of dexterity, so many different other functions which animals are not able to do. And shoulder plays a very important part in giving us lot of dexterity over other animals. A simple diagram of functional anatomy of the shoulder is like this, that you can see over here that this is the hand bone, the humerus, and this is the shoulder blade which is over here, the shoulder blade, and these are the ribs. All these form a very important part of the shoulder joint, and they are functionalized or they move because of these muscles. So there are four muscles over here at the back of the shoulder, and one muscle underneath the shoulder blade, and one muscle above on the shoulder, means at the apex, and two, three muscles going in the arm. So this is a simple functional anatomy as I would like you all to understand. The commonest condition that we see in our day-to-day life, and you must have heard from so many people, whether wrong or right, is one important condition that is known as frozen shoulder. Most of you must have confronted this in your house with your elders or even yourself. Elderly females who are diabetics are the most prone people to get frozen shoulder. This is a very classical picture of a frozen shoulder, in which now we have shown an elderly man who is not able to raise up his shoulder. Actually, all movements, active or passive, are restricted in frozen shoulder. Now, what is frozen shoulder? The other name in medical field is known as adhesive capsulitis. That means all joints, as you know, have got an internal capsule, a fibrous membrane. So this capsule of the shoulder, for unknown reasons, we science really do not know why, but it gets contracted, it gets stiff. They say it's because of some autoimmune reaction which is occurring, and as the reaction goes away or gradually weans off, the frozen shoulder becomes lax. The usual course of a frozen shoulder is 1 to 2 years. That means it starts today, it will take at least about 6 months to 1 year, or sometimes 2 years. It goes in an ascending course, reaches a peak when the movements are and the pain is really horrible, and then gradually it goes down. But if you promote exercises, if you encourage a person to do exercises, and now there are certain injections available, especially to lubricate the joint, which are not steroids, which can be given, and it reduces the course of the frozen shoulder. Apart from this, the second condition which we see is a painful arch syndrome. Now, painful arch syndrome is not usually spoken in medical circle as well as otherwise. But what is a painful arch syndrome? You see, what I would like to emphasize over here is this: in this syndrome, it's a condition which comprises many other painful conditions of the shoulder, in which, very interestingly, you see the shoulder as you lift from side, there is no pain. Up till here there is no pain. At 60 degrees once a person comes, then the pain starts, and then as he takes up, it becomes more and more painful, more and more painful, till it takes it about 120 degrees. After 120 degrees suddenly the pain disappears and he is able to take up till his ears very easily. So this arch from 60 to 120 degrees is known as a painful arch syndrome. Okay. Now there are two, three conditions which gives this particular picture or etiology or symptoms. They are, one is a rotator cuff tear. I'll talk to you about these conditions. One is a subacromial calcific deposit and subacromial bursitis, and sometimes supraspinatus tendinitis. Now, this rotator cuff tear, what is a rotator cuff tear? As I told you that the shoulder joint is moved, the movement is given by these muscles. Four are at the back of this shoulder blade and one is under. This is the subscapularis. Here there are four muscles, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, teres minor. Okay, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, teres minor and subscapularis over here. So there are four muscles which gives. Now all these muscles are attached to this arm bone, the humerus as we call it, over here on the shoulder. And they all attach together in one single tendon. Now for many reasons, this tendon tears a little and the pain is really excruciating. That patient's life is jeopardized. They can't sleep, they can't eat, they can't move the arm. So many things happens. Usually, see, elderly people who have got very lax muscles, somebody falls on an outstretched hand, an elderly person who just tries to get up with the help of a shoulder. In volleyball players, sport activities, gymnasiums, a very important example or very famous example was that of Shah Rukh Khan. He was training very hard for his film Om Shanti Om. And in that, to build up that athlete body, a gymnast body, he ruptured his rotator cuff. So since that day onwards, we call this Shah Rukh Khan disease. And the doctor who operated upon him as well as anesthetist, they have become really world famous because he is a celebrity of top class. So the simple treatment is what? That you allow this tear in the rotator cuff, these muscles, to heal by itself by putting the arm in a sling that is known as a universal shoulder immobilizer. You see, you just ask the patient to walk like this for about 2-3 weeks and he becomes all right. Give him some mild painkillers and ice packs. That sometimes if the tear is more than 1 centimeter, then we ask them to get a surgery done. Okay. Second part of this condition, this painful arch syndrome, is supraspinatus tendinitis. So you can see there is a tendon over here. If you, many a times, if you are sitting for a long time in a train or studying or doing something, you get pain over here. And there are many people who have got very large bodies and very heavy arms, like Dharmender. They get all these things. You know, their arms are so big, they get this pain over here. It's in the front part of the shoulder. So that is that supraspinatus tendon. It is really a very painful condition. We try to relieve it conservatively by ice pack, heat and painkillers. But if it doesn't yield to, then the only therapy is that you give a little amount of steroid injection over there and he's cured. The third thing is a subacromial bursitis. Now, I had told you in one of my series, a bursa is a bag of oil which God has put between tendons, muscles, bones, between two bones to lubricate the movements of all these musculoskeletal tissues so that we don't get unnecessary friction and pain. But what if that same bursa itself become painful? What if that becomes inflamed? So this is one of the bursa, the subacromial. Acromion is this. This part is known as acromion. Acromion and coracoid, two processes are there which are extensions of the shoulder blade. This is the clavicle over here. You see this part, the front bone. And this bursa is below the acromion. So when this becomes inflamed, you are not able to, again you get that painful arch syndrome, that from 60 to 120 degrees you have got pain. Most of the time simple analgesics and rest solves the problem. We sometimes use a universal shoulder immobilizer, sometimes we use a shoulder pouch. I'll show you in one of the slides what an immobilizer is. This is an immobilizer. You see, you have actually fix that shoulder. Now she is not able to do anything. She can't do anything. She cannot even do like this. But in a pouch, it hangs this thing. So the rest is over here. Then you can do and push and nudge anybody whatever you want. But here you cannot do anything. Okay. The other thing is a bicipital tendinitis. Okay. One more condition that I would like to cover is a subacromial calcification. This is rarely with that I see, once in a year. This is very rarely. some people, because of abuse of their shoulder, or you know, sometimes they consume a lot of alcohol or some drugs or something, these people, for some unknown reasons, this acromion process, as you can see, this bone, from this bone a powder comes, calcium powder, and this gets deposited in this tendon. This is that supraspinatus muscle which I was talking about. This is the tendon which gets attached to this arm bone, the humerus. Here these calcium deposits come and accumulate, and this is so painful. Oh my god, they just cannot, they don't know what to do with, and the only treatment is surgery. You have to cut open this thing from here and remove away this, scoop out this calcium, this chuna. You know, it is like, you, many people must be having seen in their homes plywood. In plywood there are those boring insects. They make small holes, and that powder comes down around that furniture. That is exactly the phenomenon over here. After this, I would like to cover this bicipital tendinitis. Now, we know, all of us have got this biceps tendon, which people try to develop in gyms and all these things and try to show off. But in doing that, or sometimes pulling a heavy furniture, you know, this tendon is of this muscle, the biceps, and the tendon goes to a small groove in this arm bone and gets attached to the shoulder. So it doesn't have much space to move, and somebody, if he pulls a heavy furniture or lifts something up, they stretch away this muscle, and then it pains. It pains a lot. This, some people, most physicians call it a frozen shoulder, but you have to classically diagnose, because we can do something about it. You see, the best thing to do is to put a thin needle behind this tendon into the bone and give a little steroid and hyaluronidase drug, and the patient immediately recovers. So this is a very important condition that we see in our day-to-day practice. After that, we got what is known as scapulocostal syndrome. Okay, there is one thing which I would like to cover. This is a very interesting condition which I am sure most of you must have experienced in your life. This is a suprascapular nerve entrapment. You see, many people who are addicted to computers, reading, their posture is very good, they are just sitting. Suddenly they feel a current, a cold wave, you know, which is going from the shoulder down. They don't know really what it is. They feel that I've got some heart attack or what, I don't know. And they're really afraid what has happened. Now, what happens is this, that there is a small nerve over here which goes below a ligament on of this shoulder blade. This is our shoulder blade at the back. So it goes above that ligament, and that gets trapped. It's a thin nerve which goes to the skin, and when it gets trapped, it gives electric currents on the back, and many